Let us continue our discussion on Chapter 3, Class 12th NCERT Biology for your NEET entrance examination. This chapter is Human Reproduction, and the topic that we are going to discuss is Section 3.3, Gametogenesis. So there would be gametogenesis in the human males and gametogenesis in the human females. So we will do these two subtopics in different videos. In this video, we will look at spermatogenesis, the formation of sperm. Sperm, you know, is the gamete of the male sex in the human beings. And the formation of the sperm, obviously, would be called as spermatogenesis. Let me just remind you that you are aware about the process of the cell division. There is an important cell division, type of cell division, which is called as meiosis. This meiosis results in the formation of the gametes or spores. So because we are talking of the human beings, so this would be gametes. And we know that the set of the chromosome is called as ploidy, and a normal somatic cell of the human body has two sets of chromosome, and therefore it is called as diploid. And the total number of chromosome in the somatic diploid cell of a human being is 46, which is actually 23 pairs. So there is a chromosome number 1 from your mother, chromosome number 1 from your father. These two chromosomes would be called as homologues. 22 pairs are autosomes, and the 23rd pair is of the sex chromosome. And after meiosis, which is actually two successive cell divisions, the resultant daughter cells are called as the gametes, or as I said, in some cases it will be called as spores, and they will be haploid. So that means they will be carrying only one set of chromosome. And what is the advantage? When the male gamete fertilizes the female gamete and both gametes are haploid, carrying only one set of chromosome, the fertilization will restore the normal diploid condition. I hope this is absolutely clear. Now, one of the most important question in the beginning would be, when does the process start in the human males? So when does spermatogenesis start in human males? The answer is at the onset of puberty. So we are saying at onset of puberty. So this is a very important question, and this onset of puberty is due to release of gonadotropin releasing hormone. And you know that gonadotropin releasing hormone is actually a hypothalamic hormone. This hormone reaches the anterior pituitary or the adenohypophysis by a portal vein, stimulates the cells that will release gonadotropins. The gonadotropins are 2, FSH and LH, and the gonadotropins are called as gonadotropins because they will be acting on the gonads, and therefore in males it would be in on testis. So this is question number 1. So we said that at onset of puberty, and it is coinciding with the release of gonadotropin releasing hormone, which is a hypothalamic hormone. Now, moving on, there would be another question is that where does it take place? So it has to happen in the primary sex organ. It happens in the testes. And we have already discussed that in the testes are present the seminiferous tubules. And the process of the spermatogenesis happens or takes place in the lumen, inside the seminiferous tubules. So seminiferous tubules are inside the testes, and inside the seminiferous tubule, this process of spermatogenesis take place. And now let us we have already done this. If we look at the wall of the seminiferous tubule, then it is lined by some cells, and these cells are called as spermatogonia. So that means the seminiferous tubules are lined by very important cells. They are called as spermatogonia. Needless to say, these spermatogonia would be diploid, which would mean that they have two sets of chromosome. That means the total number of chromosome is 46. Now what happens is that these spermatogonia are of two types, type A and type B. So these spermatogonia, they continually divide by mitosis and replenish the number of these spermatogonia continually. So some spermatogonia keep on dividing and they keep on replenishing the number of these spermatogonia. spermatogonia, and some of them actually divide to form the type B spermatogonia, and it is these type B spermatogonia that divide and mature into a cell which is called as a primary spermatocyte. So you can call this as a cell of sperm lineage, and we are talking of primary spermatocyte. Still no meiotic division has taken place, and this is all by mitosis and differentiation, and therefore we would say that the primary spermatocyte is still diploid and is having 46 chromosome. So I hope this is absolutely clear. So just to give you an idea, we are saying that these cells are continually dividing, and let us say that these cells are the primary spermatocytes. Now this primary spermatocyte divides by meiosis one. So this is where the reductional division takes place. You know that meiosis one is a reductional division, and it will divide by meiosis one. So it undergoes meiosis one, which is a reductional division, leads to the formation of two cells. So there would be one primary spermatocyte. It would have 46 chromosome. It undergoes meiosis one. The number of the daughter cells at the end of the meiosis one would be two, and each would be called as a secondary spermatocyte. So they are called as secondary spermatocytes. I hope this thing is now absolutely clear. Now these secondary spermatocytes are the first cells which are actually haploid in content. So that means the chromosome number is reduced to half. So this is, I think, absolutely clear. Meiosis one happens in primary spermatocyte. These primary spermatocytes actually give rise to the daughter cells, which will be called as the secondary spermatocytes. And now you know that each secondary spermatocyte will undergo meiosis two, and meiosis two is very akin to the mitotic division. It is again an equational division, and each will undergo meiosis two. So meiosis two, and it will result in the formation of four cells. So each, and therefore it will result in the formation of four cells. All of them would be haploid and are called as spermatids. So they are called as spermatids. So we are looking at primary spermatocyte, the secondary spermatocytes, and the spermatids. Okay, let me make the spermatids with a different color. So let us choose a different color for drawing the spermatids. Let us take this color. So we are saying these are the spermatids. They are spherical cell, as the normal cell shape usually is. So this is what is happening. So we are saying this is a spermatogonia. These are diploid cell. These are primary spermatocyte. They are also diploid cell. This is the first cell, which is actually haploid. This is secondary spermatocyte, and this is spermatid. And then what happens is that the spermatid undergoes a further process, which is called as spermiogenesis. So spermiogenesis, by the process of spermiogenesis, the Sertoli cell becomes a very differentiated cell. So the spermatid is a simple spherical cell, but it has to differentiate into a highly specialized structure of the human sperm, and that process is called as spermiogenesis. So what we will do is that we will write it again. So just to understand this thing, let us make a pictorial representation. We are saying that this is a type B spermatogonium. So this is type B spermatogonium. This is a diploid cell. Now we are saying that it divides mitotically, and then some of them differentiate into a cell which is called as the primary spermatocyte. So this cell is called as primary spermatocyte. Again, this is a diploid cell with 46 chromosome, and then this cell undergoes meiosis one. So this undergoes meiosis one. It results in the formation of two haploid cells. So these cells would be called as secondary spermatocytes. So this is a very simple thing to remember. They are secondary spermatocytes, and we are saying the chromosome number is reduced, and each secondary spermatocyte is having 23 chromosomes. Then each secondary spermatocyte will complete the meiosis. The second of the meiotic division is very similar to the mitotic division and is equational in nature and leads to the formation of ultimately the four cells that we talk about are the products of the meiotic division. And these cells, they are called as spermatids. So these cells, they are called as spermatids, and obviously we know that they are haploid. So therefore the chromosome content is the number is 23. Now what I would say tell you is this, that this process, even if we include this step as well, this process would be called as cytogenesis. So this entire sequence is called as spermatocytogenesis. There is one more step left. Now each spermatid will differentiate into a highly specialized structure that we are going to see right now after a short while. This structure is called as the sperm or the spermatozoon. And this step, the conversion of this spherical cell into a highly specialized sperm would be called as spermiogenesis. Now this is very, very clear, spermiogenesis. And together, the entire thing is called as spermatogenesis. So this entire thing is called as spermatogenesis. I hope this thing is now absolutely clear. So what can be the question? The question can be, how many sperms will result ultimately from a primary spermatocyte? The answer would be 4. So a primary spermatocyte will actually produce 4 sperm. What about secondary spermatocytes? The secondary spermatocyte each will give rise to only 2 sperms, because 2 spermatids will be the resultant cell, and each spermatid will differentiate into only 1 sperm. So 4, 2, 1. Now it is important to understand that this is not an easy process. This is not an easy process, and this process requires a lot of raw material. Lot of input is required for this thing to happen. And that is why I told you that the seminiferous tubules are lined by some tall cells. And these cells, we remember now, they are called as the Sertoli cells. Sertoli cells, as you are aware, I told you, are also called as the sustentacular or the nurse cells. Now, why they are called as the nurse cells? Because these spermatids will get associated with them. So these spermatids will get associated with them, and the raw material for the spermiogenesis, the entire support thing, would be done by the Sertoli cell. And here itself, attached to it, they will get differentiated into the sperm, and then they will get separated from the Sertoli cells into the lumen. So this is a very, very important thing to understand, that what is the function of Sertoli cell. Now, just try to understand a very, very simple fundamental. Just to tell you the basics of the thing, this is a Sertoli cell. This Sertoli cell has certainly a nucleus. This nucleus will be, this is a spermatid. I stand corrected. Please let us do it again. I am saying that this is a spermatid. So this is not a Sertoli cell. This is a spermatid. It is a spherical cell. It has 23 chromosomes. The chromosomes will be present in the nucleus. And let us say that somewhere here is located what is called as the Golgi, or let us make it the other way around. So let us say this is where the Golgi apparatus is located. Now what happens is that the entire raw material is actually provided by the Sertoli cells. The everything that is required by provide is provided by the nurse cells. And you can easily imagine a line of your NCRT, the entire sperm, because after all this is the cell that is going to differentiate into the sperm. So there is a line in your NCRT where it says that the sperm will be surrounded by a plasma membrane. This is the membrane that we are talking about, but there are some very interesting changes happening here. What happens is that this Golgi complex forms a cap-like structure, and it forms a cap-like structure. Obviously, it will be surrounded by a plasma membrane. I am not making the plasma membrane. So this Golgi will form a cap-like structure. This will be called as an acrosome, and this acrosome will be carrying some enzymes. These enzymes together, they are called as sperm lysins, and they will help in the process of the fertilization of the oocyte by the sperm. We will see later on when we discuss the topic of fertilization. Just beyond it, there would be the nucleus. So that means beyond it, there would be the nucleus. So we are saying this part is called as the head. So this part is the head. Head has basically the nucleus. It contains the genetic material that is present in the sperm. And above it, there is a cap. You obviously put a cap on your head. And this cap is actually acrosome. And just beyond it, there is a neck. So there is, well, this is what is called as a constriction. You can see this is a neck. And the neck has two pairs of centriole, and you know that the centrioles are always present in pair, and the two members are perpendicular to each other. So there would be a proximal pair of centriole and a distal pair of centrioles. So I hope this is absolutely clear. Now what is happening is that the entire thing is getting pushed down, and this thing beyond the neck forms what is called as the midpiece or the body of the sperm, where you would see that there are mitochondria, large number of mitochondria which are spirally arranged. So the mitochondria, a large number of mitochondria are located in the body or the midpiece of the sperm, and we are seeing that they are actually spirally arranged. You are seeing a cut section. You can imagine that the type of movement that I am showing with the help of my hands, that what would be the spiral arrangement. Incidentally, it is called as Nibbankarn. No need for remembering lot of terms. Now what happens is that beyond this distal pair, the distal pair of the centriole actually forms what is called as the flagellum. You know, this is the function of the centriole. So it forms the flagellum, and the flagellum will actually beyond the body will form the tail. So we know that the human sperm is actually having a tail. This tail is actually flagellum. Whenever the human sperm moves freely, it will move on its own with the help of its flagellum. It will require a lot of energy, and therefore it is adapted. You can see a large number of mitochondria are concentrated, and because the ovum is not going to provide the centriole type of thing, the centrosome, then therefore this proximal centriole will be provided by the sperm and will be utilized in the first division of the zygote, and obviously there is the payload that it has to deliver to the female gamete, and at the one end it is actually equipped with so many enzymes that will be involved in carving away on its when it is going towards the secondary oocyte to fertilize it. And this process takes lot of time, and this is called as spermiogenesis, and this is facilitated by the Sertoli cells. So again, going back to the previous diagram, we are saying that in the seminiferous tubule, you will see we are talking about the time period where there has been an onset of puberty. The spermatogenesis is taking place. You also remember that for effective spermatogenesis, a body temperature around 2 to 2.5 degrees Celsius lower than the body temperature is required. That was the purpose of the descent of the testes, and you know that there will be different stages of the cell, and if we are going again, we are repeating, we are saying spermatogonia, then primary spermatocyte, then secondary spermatocyte, then spermatids gets physically associated with the Sertoli cell, undergo the process of what is called as spermiogenesis, and then we are saying that they are released into the lumen. And when the sperms are released from the seminiferous tubule, the process would be called as spermiation. So the release of the sperms from the seminiferous tubules, the process would be called as spermiation. So there are some terms to now contend with. The one would be the entire process is called as spermatogenesis. It has two different sub things that is present. One would be spermatocytogenesis up to the formation of the spermatid, then spermatid differentiating into the mature sperm, that would be called as spermiogenesis. The Sertoli cells called as the nurse cells, and we are saying that when they are released from the seminiferous tubule, the process would be called as spermiogenesis. And I know that a primary spermatocyte will lead to the formation of 4 sperm ultimately, the secondary spermatocyte to 2 and spermatid to 1. I hope all these questions, this is a simple topic, and I hope that this is now absolutely clear. You may be asked about diploidy. Now there would be some other interesting questions. So that question would be, so let us rub this diagram. Probably we do not require it right now, so we can get rid of this diagram. Now I will be talking about here only what is called as the hormonal regulation of the male reproductive physiology. What happens? So what we are saying is that obviously we know that hypothalamus releases GnRH. So hypothalamus releases GnRH. This gonadotropin releasing hormone through a portal system reaches the anterior pituitary. It reaches anterior pituitary and stimulates some cells, some of the basophilic cells in the anterior pituitary. And the anterior pituitary releases gonadotropins. And the gonadotropins are 2 in number. One would be LH and the other would be FSH. Now, because they are gonadotropins, as I already told you, the gonadotropins should act on gonads. And then we will see, what we see is that this LH actually acts on, this is very straightforward, it acts on interstitial cells of Leydig. So do you remember the Leydig cells that were present in the interstitial spaces in the testes? So outside the seminiferous tubule, interstitial cells of Leydig, and these cells, when stimulated by the LH, will secrete androgens. And we know that the main androgen is actually testosterone. So this is a very straightforward regulation. And then we are saying is that there would be a negative feedback control type of thing. So therefore there must be a constancy in the secretion of the testosterone. And you know, we have already discussed in the chapter on chemical coordination the concept of the negative feedback control. Now regarding the effects of FSH. So these FSH, the FSH acts on what are called as the Sertoli cells. And now what happens is that these Sertoli cells will actually produce what is called as an androgen binding protein. Now just understand this. So this is the testes. In the testes, there is seminiferous tubule. The interstitial cells of Leydig are located outside the seminiferous tubule in the interstitial space. And these are the cells that are actually producing the androgens. And these androgens will regulate the process of the spermatogenesis. So this happens at the onset of the puberty. And the spermatogenesis is basically under the regulation of testosterone. But the process is going to occur inside the seminiferous tubule. And the hormone is produced by a cell that is just outside the seminiferous tubule. Now a hormone by definition should be going through the blood. And therefore, it is not going to simply diffuse here. So it will be transported by the blood. Please remember, it is a hormone. It may be located very near, but it will be transported by the blood, and something must actually bind to it and concentrate it inside the seminiferous tubule so that the process that was occurring inside the seminiferous tubule is adequately regulated. And this is the androgen binding protein that is produced by the Sertoli cells. And therefore, this androgen gets concentrated into the seminiferous tubule, where it takes care of the process of the spermatogenesis. One more thing, this step, the primary spermatocytes getting converted into the secondary spermatocyte, this is the step that is actually regulated by the FSH. So remember, the entire process is regulated by the androgen, but we are talking about the initial reaction where the primary spermatocyte undergoes the first meiotic division and produces 2 secondary spermatocytes. This is the step where the FSH comes into picture. Now, if if FSH allows this, and then the secondary spermatocytes are formed, and then the spermatids obviously will be formed, and they get associated with the Sertoli cells, and a lot of raw material and time would be required for this final maturation, which is called as for the final transformation, which is called as the process of spermiogenesis. And therefore, there must be a control mechanism in the hands of the Sertoli cell where they can actually regulate the process somewhat, because they should not be overburdened with the work. So what happens is that these Sertoli cells actually secrete another hormone. This has been asked in the NEET entrance exam once, so therefore I am giving you this. This hormone is called as inhibin, and this inhibin actually inhibits FSH, and then you can understand that the process can be adequately streamlined according to the demand and supply. This is going to happen. So this is a very simple hormonal regulation of the male reproductive physiology, and especially its relation to the process of the spermatogenesis. So I am clarifying a question again. The entire process is actually regulated by the testosterone requires. The formation of the testosterone requires LH, and you know the role of the FSH in the spermatogenesis. So all three hormones play important role in the process of the spermatogenesis in the human males. I hope this thing is absolutely clear. Now coming back to what we have already discussed, what is called as the semen. So we said that the semen would be carrying something that is produced by the testes, we should not forget this, and there would be the sperms, and obviously there would be a seminal plasma. So there would be a seminal plasma, and we have already discussed that seminal vesicles, prostate, bulbo, urethral glands, etc. will be contributing to the seminal plasma. Now for male fertility to happen, the male to be fertile, the most important thing is the effective sperm count. And we say that at least 20 million sperms. So please remember this figure, because we will be using this figure in our discussion on reproductive health. That means there must be at least 20 million sperm per ml of the semen present for the male fertility to happen. And then we say that out of the total sperm present, at least 60%, so let us use the word at least, so at least 60% should be morphologically normal. So there are a huge number of morphological abnormalities in the structure of the sperm, and we are saying that 60% should be morphologically normal. And finally, out of all, 40% must be at least, obviously this would be again, at least 40% must be vigorously motile. So must be not only motile, they must be hypermotile, they must be vigorously motile. I have already told you that on a higher side, there may be 400 million sperms present in each time in an ejaculate. 400 million, this is a big number. And we are saying that and only a single sperm is required to fertilize the ovum. So we are talking of 400 million, and only one will be able to fertilize the primary ovum. Side. So again, we say that with respect to the reproductive functions, the female sex is far, far superior to the male sex. This is one of the reasons. But for that one to reach the secondary oocyte, we say that there must be at least 20 million, and a million is 10 lakhs. So 20 million of sperms per ml. Out of them, at least 60% should be morphological normal, and 40% must be vigorously motile. So what we have discussed is 3.3 gametogenesis, the part A, the part that deals with the formation of the human male gamete, which is the sperm, and the basic concepts involved in it. When I come back, we will look at the part B of section 3.3, the formation of the female gamete or the ovum.